our studies in the book of Romans. We are in Romans chapter 15. We're going to look at verses 14 through 21 this morning. Paul writes, "And concerning you, my brethren, I myself also am convinced that you yourselves are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, and able also to admonish one another. But I have written very boldly to you on some points so as to remind you again because of the grace that was given me from God to be a minister of Christ Jesus to the Gentiles, ministering as a priest the gospel of God, so that my offering of the Gentiles may become acceptable, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in Christ Jesus, I have found reason for boasting in things pertaining to God. For I will not presume to speak of anything except what Christ has accomplished through me, resulting in the obedience of the Gentiles by word and deed." Now, let me pause for just a moment, because I think the way the New American Standard Bible reads, you might think that he is describing the obedience of the Gentiles, that it's in word and deed, but he's describing his ministry to them. What Christ accomplished through me by word and deed. I think the New International Version maybe gives a clearer sense of that, where it says, "by what I have said and done." And that is clear from what he says next in verse 19, "in the power of signs and wonders, in the power of the Spirit, so that from Jerusalem and around about, as far as Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. And thus I aspire to preach the gospel, not where Christ was already named, so that I would not build on another man's foundation, but as it is written, they who had no news of him shall see, and they who have not heard shall understand." May the Lord bless this reading of his word and bless our time of study in it together. Let's bow in a word of prayer. 2 Chronicles 20 tells the sad story of good King Uzziah's fall. He was a godly king whose success went to his head. In fact, before the incident, it's really introduced with the statement, "He was marvelously helped until he was strong." In an act of pride, he entered the temple to burn incense on the altar. That was forbidden, and he knew that. Only the sons of Aaron could be priests. As I say, he knew that, but he refused to stop until leprosy broke out on his forehead. He was rushed out, but it was too late. He died a leper. It was a shocking reminder that in ancient Israel, only a select few could be priests. All that changed on the day of Pentecost, so that Paul can write in Romans 15 about his ministry as a priest. What a privilege. We are priests. And yet from the early days of Christianity, there were those, and still are, who believed the church was divided between clergy and laity, priests and parishioners. The Roman church, to which this letter was written, forgot what is taught here and changed greatly just a few generations after Paul's day. It wasn't until Martin Luther and the Reformation that the priestly caste system was smashed and the doctrine of the priesthood of all believers was rediscovered. The Reformation was really a return to the book of Romans and what Paul writes here about his priestly ministry. What he wrote tells us a lot about our ministry and what a privilege we have. Romans 15, verse 14 is the beginning of the end of the book. Paul's explanation of Christian doctrine and his exhortation to Christian living, they're finished. But in verse 14 through verse 21, Paul tells about his ministry. He speaks of it as a priestly ministry, but explains that its effectiveness is due altogether to Jesus Christ. Now, this is not the doctrinal section of the book. It is finished, as I said, but in verses 16 through 19, we have doctrine. In fact, we have doctrine all through this section. Verses 16 through 19 are really built on the doctrine of the Trinity. Verse 18 is all about sovereign grace. But Paul begins by stating his confidence in the Roman Christians to fix the problems that he has discussed with them, that of debatable things and Christian liberty. He gives three reasons for his confidence. They are full of goodness, he writes, filled with all knowledge, and able also to admonish one another. Now, those are three characteristics of a mature church. Their goodness is their opposition to wickedness and their approval of righteousness. Earlier in chapter 3, Paul wrote, you'll remember, there is none who does good. But this is what grace does for the natural man. It transforms him or her so that we do have true goodness. So as a church, these Romans were manifesting God's life in their lives. They were living upright, moral lives because they were changed by the grace of God and because they were filled with the knowledge of God. That's the next description that Paul gives. They were filled with all knowledge. They understood the Christian faith. Paul had never been to Rome. He'd not met these people personally, but he evidently knew them by reputation, and he knew that this was a mature church. That gave him confidence that they would handle their Christian liberty well, and the strong would help the weak to move on to maturity. They were able, he said, to admonish one another. And as I said earlier, that's what a mature church does. It cares about its members, each for one another, and they point out those needs that Christians have as mature Christians. When they see difficulties, when they see shortcomings, they point them in the right direction so that they don't go astray. They admonish them. They encourage them. Now, as Paul explains in the next verses, that was very much the reason that he had written this letter to them. He wrote to remind them of the truth for their good and their spiritual maturity. That's instructive. They're a mature church. They were filled with all knowledge. Still, they needed to be reminded of the great truths of the Christian faith. And we all do. As we go over old truths, we gain new and deeper insights into them. And no doubt the Romans learned much from Paul's letter and advanced in the faith as a result of the letter that he'd written to them. We all need that. We need to review the great truths of the faith, the doctrines of the Trinity, the atonement, our priesthood. So in another 15 years, Believer's Chapel will be in need of another series on the book of Romans to go over these great doctrines of the faith. Years ago, I read an article by one of the nation's leading educators in which he criticized American universities for not requiring basic history courses. He made the statement, "What is not taught will be forgotten, and what is forgotten will not be or cannot be defended." I thought that was a good statement, and I think that's a statement that applies to the church as well. It applies to us in terms of our faith, our doctrine, our set of beliefs. If we don't remind ourselves of the truths of the faith, they'll be forgotten, and if they're forgotten, they won't be defended. And soon the church will grow weak and grow ineffective, and when it's ineffective, its guard is down, and error will seep in. So, giving Rome a reminder of the great doctrines of Christianity was a good reason for writing this letter to them, and that is reason enough for writing the letter to them. But it was also Paul's calling to write them and remind them. He was an apostle. He describes his apostleship as the grace that was given to him by God. And so because he was an apostle, he knew they needed this reminder and this direction that he gave here. And because he was an apostle, the reminder and the information and all that he gives them here has great authority. That's the authority of the apostles. It has the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ whom he represented. But also what he did in writing this letter was done with real care. It was done as an act of worship. That's how he describes his ministry to them in the next line, not as some official act, not as just an authoritative letter that was sent to them, but as a ministry of personal concern for them and as unto the Lord. It's a priestly act. He tells them that he was ministering as a priest the gospel of God. And his object, his purpose in doing that here was to make the Gentiles, an offering that was acceptable and sanctified by the Lord. He wanted to offer them up, as it were, to the Lord. Think of Aaron and what Aaron, the high priest, did. He prayed for the people. He carried their names on his shoulder and his breastplate. He brought them before the Lord. He prayed for them, but he also made offerings and sacrifices and whole burnt offerings. I think in that light, Paul is describing his ministry and these Gentiles. His ministry is to be an offering to God, especially in the Gentiles who he'd offer up as sanctified people, as acceptable people. So what was restricted to the sons of Aaron under the law has been expanded to the Apostle Paul, to believers in Jesus Christ in all ages. In this great age of grace, we've been made priests. Peter calls us a royal priesthood. That's the doctrine of the priesthood of all believers. And we are priests. It's not only the priesthood of all believers, but it's the priesthood of believers to all believers. And that's the point that Martin Luther made when he spoke on this subject. He said, every Christian is someone else's priest, and we are all priests to one another. And we are priests like Paul was, not up for offering up incense and animals on the altar, but giving the gospel so that souls could be offered to the Lord that are acceptable and sanctified. And then that they, by the Spirit's power, offer themselves up as living and holy sacrifices acceptable to God, according to Romans 12, verse 1. Now, that was Paul's ministry. It involved traveling over dusty roads and rough terrain, working hard, earning a living during the day, making tents so that he would not be a burden on the church. Sometimes there was loneliness, sometimes rejection, sometimes exposure, shipwrecks, beatings, imprisonment. But all of that, even what was sometimes mundane, was part of his priestly ministry. And that's how we're to view our lives. There are no more apostles in the age in which we live. Apostles and prophets were first century gifts, and they were the foundation of the church. That's how Paul describes them in Ephesians 2:20. They are no more. But all believers are priests, and our lives are to be lived as a priestly service to God. We have all been called to this service, and it is the highest service there is in all of the world, to be a priest of God. Our lives are to be a fragrant aroma to God, like the incense of the temple. Whatever we do is to be done for the Lord, to His glory, as a priestly service. If you're a Sunday school teacher, that's your priestly service. And a great privilege it is to teach children or to teach adults the things of God. It is service that God has given you to do. But perhaps you're not gifted to teach. Maybe your gift is helps or giving or something else. All of us have a gift. But we're all priests to use those gifts and to know the other priests, the other sheep, so that we can involve ourselves with them, to know them, to be able to minister to them so that they will be offered up as acceptable and sanctified to God. So we are able to give them encouragement. We're able to give them admonitions. We're able to pray for them. That's priestly service. If you're a parent, it's your area of priestly service to minister within the home. I don't mean just get your glove out and play catch with your boy. That's good. I don't disparage that at all. I played catch with my grandson the other day. That's a good thing to do. But teach him the Word of God. Teach him the doctrines of the faith. That's your priestly ministry. Wherever we are priests. So our conduct at home or in business, in public or in private, is a witness and is to be consistent with the gospel that we represent and proclaim. But proclaiming it is principally what Paul is describing here as his priestly ministry. And Paul was very clear about the gospel that he preached. The book of Romans is all about that gospel. It is about grace. It is about what Christ has done as our substitute in judgment. Christ has saved us from God's punishment for our sins by dying in our place. That salvation is received as a free gift through faith alone, in Christ alone, and it is all the result of grace alone. That's the gospel. And Paul guarded it jealously. The first heresy of the church was a corruption of that. Now, it wasn't a denial of the deity of Christ. It wasn't a denial of the humanity of Christ. It wasn't a denial of the Trinity. It was not a denial. It was not a subtraction. It was an addition of works to faith. In fact, it was an addition of one work, one ceremony, circumcision, which was to say it was the addition of human merit to God's grace, which corrupted that grace. In fact, so corrupted it that Paul could say it's another gospel or a different gospel, meaning it's not the gospel at all. When Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, were serving as priests, they burned incense with fire from the altar. It was what is called strange fire that was offered before the Lord, and they died for doing it. A false gospel is strange fire, and God curses it and those who preach it. Paul preached the pure gospel. When he came to Corinth, he said that he determined to know nothing among them except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's the gospel. And giving it is a priestly ministry. Paul devoted his life to it, and he had much to show for it. Through his ministry, many Gentiles had become offerings to God. He says in verse 17 that he could boast about that, but it's a boast that he would make in Christ Jesus, meaning all that he had done in the strength that Christ gave to him. He had accomplished much, but he could not boast about it as though it were his doing. It was not. God had done it all through him. That's the way it always works. That's the way it works in our life. Our priestly ministry will be a successful ministry to the degree that the Lord God works through us. That's what makes it effective. He states that further in verses 18 and 19, where he describes his ministry as the Lord's doing and as powerful. In fact, in verse 19, he repeats the word power twice. And by God's grace and power, Paul witnessed responses to the gospel that he preached as he preached all through Asia and Europe. He says in verse 19, from Jerusalem and round about as far as Illyricum. Illyricum is modern day Albania and parts of Serbia and Bosnia. And that's where he went. He's always expanding out and moving toward Rome, moving toward Spain. It was a great work. It required great effort. It required wisdom. It required skill in preaching and teaching, great discipline and sacrifice on Paul's part. He is the greatest missionary of the church. No man has a greater boast than the Apostle Paul. No king or conqueror or politician has ever accomplished what he did. The great walls of Babylon are dust. The forum in Rome is a ruin. But Paul's work continues today. His mission affected the course of Western history in the saving of souls. As many Gentiles were brought to faith through his preaching, Paul took no credit for that. His boast is in the Lord. As he says in verse 18, he would speak of nothing except what Christ has accomplished through him. He doesn't say what he has accomplished through Christ, but what Christ has accomplished through him. It's Christ's action, not Paul's. I noticed this some time back, a quote from Dr. Johnson in his commentary on this passage. He writes, "Modern ministers and modern ministries like to lay great stress on numbers, but the apostle would have none of that. To lay great stress on numbers often reflects a departure from the principle of dependence on God for all our resources." And then he went on to mention Ray Steadman, who was the minister at Peninsula Bible Church in Palo Alto, California. And Steadman would refer to David's numbering of the people as an example of that, of depending on the arm of the flesh. Now, having said that, verse 18, Paul does say that Gentiles became obedient by word and deed, meaning by Paul's word and deed, his preaching and praying and traveling and action. That's necessary. Paul was a man of thought and action who understood the grace of God and reflected it in his speech and deeds, in the way that he treated people. He was an active and very responsible man. And Paul accomplished much. He wasn't inactive, he was active. But he accomplished much because his own drive and fortitude and wisdom were due to the power of God in him. Christ, through the Holy Spirit, was working through him. In Paris, not far from Notre Dame Cathedral, there is a small Gothic church called Saint-Chapelle. It's where the medieval kings of France would worship. It's surrounded by stained glass windows. On a sunny day, it is spectacular as the light shines through the red and the blue and the yellow glass. There's nothing in Gothic architecture quite like it. But take away the light and the beauty's gone. There's nothing to be seen. The glory is the sun. And it was the same with Paul. He had many gifts. He had many abilities. He was a man of intellectual genius and energy and action. But apart from Christ, it would have been like stained glass in the dark. It was the Lord who gifted him, the Lord who animated him, the Lord who energized the apostle and gave him success. As the Lord himself said, apart from me, you can do nothing. And Paul is saying that. Paul did not accomplish much through Christ. Christ accomplished everything through Paul. And he did it in two ways, through Paul's words and Paul's works. Those were the two weapons in Paul's arsenal, and they must be our weapons also. But they happened in Paul in a unique way, as he explains in verse 19, in the power of signs and wonders, in the power of the Spirit. Paul's deeds were supernatural works. They were miracles. They are called signs because they point beyond themselves to truth about God, truth about the gospel. They are wonders because that's what they produce in those who behold them. They produce a sense of wonder, a sense of awe in what they've witnessed. This is a rare expression in Paul's writings. It's used only one other place of his ministry, and that's in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 12, where he describes these as the signs of a true apostle. Miracles authenticated the apostolic ministry and message. That ministry of the apostles is finished. The foundation of the church has been laid. The New Testament is our authority, and the canon is closed. Now, that doesn't mean that God can't do miracles today. He does what he wills, and we pray that he would do great things, wonderful things. We pray for healing, that he would heal someone. We pray that. I pray those kinds of prayers. I pray that he will intervene to change the circumstances of life. And pray diligently about that. We pray that. We pray, hopefully, according to his will. And we look for an answer because prayer is effective. It's what it's the means that God has given us to gain the blessings that the Lord has for us. So he can do amazing things and does, in fact, amazing things in answering prayer. But we live in a different situation from the apostolic age. There are no apostles today giving fresh revelation. There are no prophets today giving fresh revelation. People are not being healed by an apostle's shadow falling on them as when Peter walked through the streets of Jerusalem. For all the talk about contemporary signs and wonders and modern day miracles, the phenomena of the first century are not occurring today. Now, that doesn't mean, again, that miracles aren't happening. They are, and they are just as great. They are even greater today than they were in the past, or as great, certainly. Because they are occurring through the preaching of the gospel and the teaching of the word of God. Donald Gray Barnhouse tells the story of a Christian who was asked, no doubt by a skeptic, if he could turn water into wine. And he answered, he could do a miracle more wonderful than that. He told of an alcoholic who had kept his family in poverty and misery until he was led to Christ, so that through the power of the gospel, we turned whiskey into milk for his babies. Every conversion of a sinner into a saint is a miracle. That is power far greater than the power of raising the dead. Lazarus was raised from the dead. Tabitha was raised from the dead. Eutychus was raised from the dead, only to die again. But those who are converted to Christ are raised from spiritual death to spiritual life, which is life everlasting. Even though they die, they live and will be raised from the dead in the resurrection to come. And the life that they live now, the life that all of us as believers in Jesus Christ live now, is life in Christ. It is new life. And we're being changed. That's the work of sanctification. We are being changed. Liars become truthful. The immoral are changed into people of purity. The lazy are made industrious. Cold, dead, hard hearts are made alive and warm and loving toward all. That's the work of the gospel. That's the work of the Holy Spirit through the gospel. Peter called the gospel imperishable seed. It is what the Holy Spirit uses to produce the new birth. So we tell others about Christ, and the Spirit through that regenerates people so that they understand and believe. Through the gospel, the Spirit of God gives life. We don't give life, the Spirit gives life. We preach the gospel, he makes it effective. That is miraculous. And all of this is very encouraging. Our priestly service is really the sovereign work of God, done in the power of the Spirit as Christ works through us. He makes feeble human words effective. He illuminates darkened minds. John Stott called every conversion a power encounter in which the Spirit, through the gospel, rescues and regenerates sinners. And we can add to that, sanctifies them and will someday glorify them. Well, that was Paul's ministry. It was supernatural. And that's our ministry. Essentially the same. We have that same priestly ministry to offer the gospel, and in so doing, work by the power of the Spirit to affect and change and help to sanctify lives and offer them up as offerings to the Lord God. Well, in verses 20 and 21, Paul describes his priestly service as a pioneering ministry. He went where others had not gone, and he did that by design, as he explains in verses 20 and 21. And thus I aspired to preach the gospel, not where Christ was already named, so that I would not build on another man's foundation. Paul's strategy was to go to major cities. You see that as you read through the book of Acts. You gather that this was how he strategized the progress of the gospel. He looked at the major population centers and he went there. And so he would go and he would evangelize. He'd go to the synagogue and he'd preach until he was turned out of the synagogue. He'd go to the marketplaces where he'd meet the Gentiles and he would preach the gospel there, and he would get into discussions and debate. But he would, through that, plant churches through the men and women who were brought to faith through the preaching of the gospel. And then leave those in the church to do the work of spreading the gospel to outlying areas. And Paul would then move on to another area. But that was his strategy, but his guiding ambition in all of that was to go where the gospel had not been preached before. That was Paul's calling as the apostle to the Gentiles. Now, it's not the calling of every minister. It's not the calling of every Christian. And we, in a sense, in a very real sense, we're all ministers. We're all priests. We don't have this particular calling. We could say that's really unique to the Apostle Paul. And so for some, for many, the calling is to build on another man's work. And Paul describes that difference in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 6, where he compares his ministry with that of Apollos in Corinth. He said, I planted, Apollos watered, but God was causing the growth. Then in verse 10, he compares himself to a wise master builder who laid a foundation and another is building on it. That didn't mean that Paul never ministered to churches that he didn't plant. He did. In fact, this letter is proof of that. Paul did not establish the church in Rome. We don't know who established it. It may have been established by Jews that had been in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost and went back to Rome. We don't know. But Paul did not establish it, and yet he's eager to go there and minister there. So he did go to places and build on churches that had been planted by someone else. But as a rule, he went into areas where others had not been. He preached the gospel to those who had not heard it. And he had a scripture that supported his policy. It was Isaiah 52, verse 15, which he quotes in verse 21. They who had no news of him shall see, and they who have not heard shall understand. Now that refers to the servant of the Lord, to the Messiah and his mission. That's what the Lord would do. The verse begins, he will sprinkle many nations, meaning he will purify them by means of his sacrifice. He's going to redeem Gentiles, is what he's saying. And they will recognize him as their ruler. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him, Isaiah says. They will see and understand what they had not seen before and what they had not known. Paul identified Christ as the servant who would save the Gentiles and saw his ministry as participating in that prophecy as he told the unevangelized about the Savior. That is a great ministry. That is a priestly ministry. And we all have an opportunity to participate in it by telling others about Christ. And not just that, but by ministering to each other's needs, bearing one another's burdens, as Paul tells us to do in the book of Galatians. What a privilege. Even the kings of Israel could not do, you and I can do. Every Christian is someone else's priest, and we are all priests to one another, as Luther said. The Romans were acting in that way by admonishing each other, by correcting and directing each other, by being patient with each other, by teaching and encouraging each other, bearing each other's burdens. That's the priestly service we give to one another and through our faithfulness what we offer up to the Lord God. But to offer it, we must first offer ourselves to the Lord to present our bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God. We must consecrate ourselves to Him daily. But to do that, you must first believe in the Lord God by believing in Christ, His Son, who is God's servant, who died in our place, who took our punishment at Calvary, so that all who believe in Him will be saved and not perish. So if you're here without having believed in Jesus Christ, believe in Him. That's the good news. That's the good news of the gospel that penetrated throughout the world and that, as I said, shaped Western history, in fact, shaped all of human history. That's the good news. We have a Savior. It's Jesus Christ. Trust in Him and then rest and rely on Him in the priestly service that He's given you to do. May God help all of us to do that. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your goodness to us. We thank You for this great text of Scripture. One more. Great texts of Scripture in the book of Romans. We thank You for this glorious book that magnifies Your glory and clarifies the gospel. It tells us of these great privileges that we have, not only being justified, not only being made right with You, not only being in the present sanctified, but we are priests, all of us, and we have a great ministry before us. May we be faithful to it. We thank You for the Lord Jesus that's brought us into Your family. It's in His name we pray. Amen.